Okay, thank you for attending. I hereby call this meeting to order, and please join me in saluting the flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. If everyone could just join me for a quick moment of silence. We lost school committee person Jim Daly, who left us all too early. So he served in Ward 6, and I'd just like to have a moment of silence on his behalf, please. Thank you. Okay, the next item on our agenda is the hearing of visitors. Seeing that there are no visitors who signed in, we will move on to the consent agenda. The consent agenda is the bundling of routine business of the school committee, and this is an opportunity for any of the school committee members to remove any item or items they wish to discuss in further detail. If no one needs to do that, then we vote on it as a block. So is there any school committee member that would like to remove any item from the consent agenda for further discussion? Okay, seeing none, could someone make a motion to approve items A through F? A second. Mr. DiAgostino, any further discussion? Seeing none, all in favor? Opposed? Just to inform everyone, the mayor is feeling under the weather this evening, so he is not here and didn't wish to spread whatever he has to all of us, so he's being considerate. And Mr. Sullivan is unable to attend this evening because his wife is recovering from surgery, and he needed to be with her this evening. Otherwise, he would have been here. So, next item on the agenda is communication, report of superintendent of schools. Madam Superintendent, good evening.
Thank you. And as always, I want to start with our student representative, Gavin Rocha. But before I do, because I'm sure Gavin will talk to you about things happening at the high school, I want all of you to know that Gavin, for one of his jobs, works with our pool program, lifeguard, instructor. And a number of years ago, and I can't tell you exactly what year it was, but we had a number of special needs parents that approached us in talking about additional things, extracurricular activities that their children could do. One of the most popular programs we have is instruction for swimming. So we started a program called SNAP, a Special Needs Aquatics Program. I can still remember the first day, some of the children having difficulty getting into the pool. And I want to credit a number of people, Michelle Zachary, her very talented staff, Gavin being one of them. So where we have come all these years later is we are now preparing students not just to learn to swim, but to compete in Special Olympics. And Gavin, I want to tell everybody that you recently took part in a so-called polar plunge. I saw the pictures, I saw the video, and this was just, if you can imagine it, about two weekends ago, and no, it was not 70 that Saturday. It was actually freezing, although the sun was out. And Gavin and a number of our lifeguards, I know they had a page, and I know they are going to be doing some fundraising also to support these very worthy youngsters. I want to thank you. You've done an excellent job, and please share that with your whole team.
Thank you.
You're on.
Okay, thank you. So last week we had the FBI Academy, which was a huge success. 80 students attended and heard from field agents on how to become an agent in the FBI. They also talked about social media dangers and ways to protect your identity, the opioid and heroin epidemic, and the impact on the addicted and their families was also mentioned. Officer Lieberg from the Brockton Police also attended and will work with Ms. Wolder to offer some additional workshops this year and during the summer to hopefully continue with the FBI Academy. Spring sports season tryouts will begin next week. There was an IB AP dual enrollment workshop this evening in the Red Cafeteria for students and parents interested in those courses. Based on my experience personally, I like to challenge myself personally, and these classes offer this offer these challenges themselves to take course at a higher level in the high school. Brockton High parents teacher conferences are this Thursday from 6 to 8, and 10th grade ELA MCAS is next Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday. It's important for all sophomores to take this test very seriously. You need to graduate, and they need to be well rested, which is very important. Thank you. That's it.
Okay, can I just add a couple of things there? One thing I want you to know, you mentioned AP, IB program courses. I've certainly met with Principal Wolder. I know that is one of her objectives, is to take a look at increasing. You know that we recently received an award, but that is our goal, to challenge numbers of students to make sure that these students have the opportunity and reap the benefits of having taken these courses and reached the score that they need, and it makes a difference, of course, in the courses that they take during their college years. So again, thank you to Principal Wolder for making that a priority. I also want to mention to parents out there, I've had the opportunity all year long to meet with students at the high school. I call it student voices. I've met with the senior, members of the senior class, the junior class, and last Thursday I met with the sophomore class. And one of the questions that came up, it talked about the stress of preparing for the MCAS exam, which is the high-stakes test students need to pass in order to receive their high school diploma. And one of the things, when a student brought that up, and I just want to share this with all families, and I know their teachers do this all the time, it is preparation, it's hard study, and it is also making sure, again, that the student gets a good night's sleep, that they are nourished, that they're ready, like any kind of a challenge, to take it on head on. So parents, I'm asking you to make sure you're talking to your students, you're reassuring them, as we continue to do with our teaching staff here at Brockton High and our alternative pathways for those students taking the 10th grade MCAS. So thank you, Gavin. And let me continue on. We have a number of presentations this evening. I'm going to be very pleased to present our Empower Yourself program. We have a special education presentation, and we also have a park update. So that being said, I'm going to try to keep my comments brief. I will tell you what the hard work going on right now is, working on the budget. And it is certainly taking on a number of different areas. So I've mentioned publicly to the school committee and in our work in our finance subcommittee is we're working on it in a number of fronts. We're working with our legislative group. I talk to them almost on a daily basis. Right now, the governor's budget will be going through the House into the Senate. A final budget will be presented, but I met today with women superintendents from around the state. There is hard work going on because, again, it isn't just Brockton. We seem to be hard hit by these numbers during this budget term. But I will say there is a lot of hard work. We continue to talk to our city council and certainly our school committee as we watch that happen. One of the things that we will do is by March 25th, that was our date, to look at on a number of fronts our administrative positions. And I want you to know, as we work on this budget, our hope is, as the city's budget becomes clearer, as we look at the House and Senate and the final budget being clearer, that we will be able to make, this will be the superintendent's recommended budget, but hopefully we will be able to go back and infuse some of these cuts that we will be looking at in the budget. I also want you to know that we will be looking by April 15th for those things beyond the school day, and we are committed to, by the end of April, hoping to reduce any reductions, again, to supporting our students in those classrooms. Now, I say that knowing the reality right now of the budget deficit that we are facing, but we will do everything to look at programs. But I will tell you, I'm out there, I'm in the schools, and our class sizes are reaching a point where, again, we cannot go any higher in these class sizes. So we need to be looking at everything else. I'm bringing principals together. We have small groups going with our executive team, looking at everything from grants to looking at overtime to looking at all programs, and see if we can make sure that we are putting forward a budget that has left no stone unturned as far as money to support our teachers in the classroom. So we will continue to do that. I also want you to know that I'm meeting on a regular basis with Jay Condon, our chief financial officer for the city, Aldo Petronio, our chief budget officer, and to continue to look at support for this budget. So I do feel like this is a team approach. There certainly will be no finger pointing, but we will make sure that every penny that needs to come to the Brockton Public School comes to the Brockton Public Schools. And I am going to say publicly, some of the things when you talk about your school system, a level three school system, you'll hear about awards tonight. You're going to hear about a special education program where people move to the city of Brockton to receive the services that we are able to give to our students. You know, these are the kind of things that make us the district that we are. And again, I'm going to say this to the residents, that we are going to have to be looking at buildings, looking at, again, our facilities, making sure our children have technology. And I'm not sure what that's going to take. You know, does it take a debt exclusion? Does it take a look at an override? That is something that probably needs to be posed to our voters. So I hope you, again, I'll keep you updated as we go forward. And again, we are continuing to look at everything we can to put forward a responsible budget. I also want to thank publicly Superintendent of the Mansfield Public School, Zeph Gianetti. We had a situation that has been well publicized, and it's interesting because how quickly we become the back pages when we see a number of other high schools and students taunting each other during high school games. We had a situation in Brockton with students from Brockton and Mansfield. I believe it was a Friday night ago at our boys basketball tournament game. And I want to tell you how proud I am, and I've been, and many of you have, in the gym at Brockton High, when we welcome students from all over and make sure that when they come into our environment, and yeah, it's competitive, it's kind of fun. All of us remember the stamping on the ground, miss that ball, all of those chants. I was a cheerleader, probably many of you were. Those are things that are healthy competition. When you walk into a gym in Brockton High School, we have, again, our teachers there. We have housemasters present. We have our principal, our associate principal at pretty much most every game. Our students know how to be welcoming, they know how to behave, and we are proud, again, of their demeanor during those times. Now, that being said, you know, when we went to Mansfield, there was a situation where the Mansfield athletic director had taken part in an MIAA program that talked about creating healthy environments during game nights. They had something called a beach night, one of the Friday night games. They had another called camouflage night, I think a costume night. The night that we were there, a predetermined event was USA night. But again, some of the taunting and some of the comments and the crowd cheering made our players, our fans, very uncomfortable. And I want to thank, again, Superintendent Gianetti, who we sat down, we actually met face-to-face. We put forward a joint statement, and we are committed to making sure our children, our students, understand it's a teachable moment. You know, the demeanor, the welcoming, the competition, and right now I'm working with Principal Wolder, and we're taking a look at the possibility of bringing two groups of students together from Mansfield and Brockton High School, and to have very common dialogue, because I guarantee you, when students come together and have these conversations, they're going to find many things more alike than are not alike. So I, again, want to thank Mansfield for working very closely to us, and I will keep you updated on that. I also want to talk about a number of events. I jotted down these dates, and I first want to go back to the 6th of March. I actually attended here at Brockton High School the children's concert. Again, it was a wonderful event. Our students from South Middle School were actually, our chorus came and sang. We had the symphony. If you had an opportunity to come, Amy Corum put on a wonderful concert, a concert that she actually, as a young girl here at Brockton High School, performed over 50 years ago. It was well attended, students enjoyed it, and I want to thank her and everybody that worked to make that happen. Also, I had the opportunity last Monday to go before the City Council and talk about the automatic defibrillators that we have throughout. The City Council was very appreciative of the work of the Brockton Public Schools to make sure not only do we have them in the gyms, on the athletic fields, in every one of our buildings, and continue to put out training for all of our staff and some of our students. So again, congratulations to everybody that works very hard for that. Last week I went to the choral concert of Such a Dream. I want to congratulate Matt Cunningham. Absolutely fabulous. You cannot believe you're sitting there with high school students performing. Please take an opportunity to look at the calendar going forward. many spring concerts happening, end-of-the-year concerts throughout the school district. If you have an opportunity, whether it's middle school, whether it's your elementary, and certainly our high school, get out there. And two events that were kind of near and dear to my heart. This past Thursday, we had the 75th anniversary of the Strand Theater fire here in Brockton. And my dad was a firefighter for many years, president of the firefighters in his later years. So when I talk about near and dear to my heart, I remember my dad carrying around a coin forever. On one side of the coin were the 13 lives lost in the Strand fire, and on the other side was 1972. It was the Vendome fire in Boston. And until 9/11, the highest deaths in a fire were here at your Strand Theater. So congratulations again to our firefighters for always remembering the dedication of those firefighters and those families that lost their lives in the Strand fire. I also had an opportunity on Saturday to attend our public safety mass at St. Patrick's, where you had your firefighters, your police in Brockton, your first responders, just a wonderful event and a real tribute to them. So that is my update.
Questions or comments for the superintendent? No? Okay.
Okay, then the first group we'll bring up today is Empower Yourself with Cedric Turner and his group. Mr. Turner, please come up. Peter Simbor, teacher from the Asheville School. Yeah, we won't. I want to mention that Empower Yourself is a financial literacy program. Mr. Turner brought this program to our school district, I believe, during the 2011-2012 school year. Since that time, and I'm sure they'll be sharing it with you today, numbers of students have gone through this program at a couple of our middle schools, most recently Brockton High School. They're students that are very active in their own learning. These are people that we know, again, when they choose to go on to college and career, will certainly have an education before they've ever gotten to the point of going to college, an education that has been very worthy of certainly your talents and your dedication to these students. So I think you'll be presenting to us, and I know we have some awards to talk about at the end.
Thank you very much. My name is Peter Zimbor. Can you hear me? I guess you can. I'm a sixth grade teacher, very proud sixth grade teacher at the Asheville Middle School in Brockton. And as Mrs. Smith said, this program came here in 2011. It was the gentleman to my left, Mr. Cedric Turner, who brought that to us. And luckily, he got John Jerome to see value in this. And John Jerome began this as a after-school program at the Asheville and the North and the Plouffe. So we're very grateful to John Jerome for that. There we go. The mission, very briefly, it's to provide comprehensive, highly interactive, hands-on financial and economic information, enabling our students to make sound economic financial decisions in their daily lives and for the rest of their lives. We culminate all of our hard work and training with financial literacy competitions at the Federal Reserve, Gillette Stadium, and recently at Bridgewater State University. On February 25th, Bridgewater State University in the high school division, our Brockton teams came in first, second, and third, defeating the national champion, Greenwich, Rhode Island. Yes. To make a comment about that, Greenwich is a very impressive school. They did very well. They came with a great deal of resources. That's the first time they've lost in 3.5 years. They were recently featured on MSNBC News. Maybe MSNBC News should be in Brockton.
Right. Exactly.
And if you would pardon a teacher's pride, please, Asheville Middle School, we came in third in the middle school division, a very competitive field. Before this program got to the high school and had this tremendous beginning success, we were competing at Gillette Stadium, and students from Asheville and North appeared on Channel 5's Chronicle magazine. Think of this, they're middle school students holding their own against some of the top high schools in New England and beyond. A producer from Chronicle magazine came to me and said, "Can I talk to your Brockton students?" And absolutely. And they did a terrific job that night on Chronicle. Okay. And here are your winners. Here is the first place team. Opal Polonese and Angela Gertier. Their issue was income inequality. The second team winner right here was Illicit Drug Trade with Angela Frazis, Gittleson, Maria, Marshall, and Mary. Terrific job. Third place was Game of Loans with Jordan King, Maite Abigail Dennis, Megan Gesslin, and Assad Aden. And third place, middle school, Ashfield, Joshua Lovingry, Jalen DeRosa, Abdul Abbas, and Talia Houston. And I'd like to, before you clap, would you just do me a favor and take a look at that for a minute? Look at how they look. They are professional. They look professional. They act professional. They are professional. And they know that being professional and courteous in manner and dress, it works. It will never go out of fashion. That's something. Basically, what we're doing, it started out as an after-school program in the middle schools, and we're exposing children to the language of money and economics. They're learning about financial behavior, the importance of savings, budgeting, the stock market, world economic views, the power of time and compound interest in saving early, as well as good presentation and dressing for success. And just some pictures of them in action. Every single presentation, I can tell you, was excellent. The collaboration that you saw that day with our students was sincere, genuine, and meaningful. They did project boards. There was a wonderful moment when my boss happened to be there and she stepped away for a little bit. We didn't know where she went. She literally ran down the street to the Bridgewater State Bookstore, came back with any extra supplies she thought we might have needed to make what we were doing even better. So we appreciated that very much. By the way, there was a very special moment at the competition. I've never seen them do this, and I'd love to take credit for it, but I had nothing to do with it. Our students went down to the judges. These are very important people, on their own, and shook hands with every single one of them warmly and thanked them for being there to judge us. That was impressive. Every Brockton team did a superb job with their project boards, PowerPoints, and then when they were done, they had to take some very challenging questions from a very impressive group of judges. Not to name them all, but one of them was the Associate Dean of Harvard Medical School. Representative Gonzalez, a very important state rep from Springfield, drove all the way out just to be there that day. Ron Burton, who's associated with the New England Patriots and Ron Burton Training Village. They were very impressed with Brockton children. And this picture right here is at Bentley University, the only live stock trading room, I believe, in North America. And that gentleman, of course, is the man who makes it all possible, Mr. Cedric Turner. I can't begin to tell you what he brings to this. Without his connections to the sports world, the Patriots, the Red Sox, the Celtics, the investment world, Morgan Stanley and more, Jordan's Furniture, Elliot Tattleman, the banking community, he is opening doors for our kids. And our kids are going through those doors. We really have had excellent administrative support, even despite the cuts at the middle school level. Unfortunately, many students aren't able to participate because they're involved in other things during the school day, like band and chorus, but hopefully someday that will come back and we'll get that. The city provides transportation for us, and we're very, very grateful to Superintendent Smith, Assistant Superintendent Mike Thomas, and of course, Adna Pereira. There are a lot of materials related to this effort, and they are provided by Bridgewater State University, Federal Reserve, Morgan Stanley, Bentley University, including some amazing lunches where they really are working lunches. These people, these children are really working hard. I just want to share in a closing statement here that I had a very special moment at Morgan Stanley. We're on the top floor and the view of the Boston skyline was second to none. And our students had been working hard all morning, and during the luncheon they're getting the results back for what they had done that morning. And I couldn't figure out why would these executives who make huge money be spending really most of their day talking to Brockton kids. And one of the executives said it to me, "We know a winner when we see one." And that's the truth. So what I'd like to do is just say a very special thank you to our students, very important, our families, our parents that are here tonight, and certainly to this committee for sharing and recognizing these wonderful, wonderful students. Thank you.
Let me just say, in fact, this. I would like to have that you guys was really, really, in fact, was thanked in terms of that's your time. But I kind of think one of the things that we have to do is we have to have the type of kids gave was the access. And I think in a lot of other type of what's the neighborhoods, a lot of other type of come type of what's the communities, they have access. And, you know, a lot of my kids here don't. And they are was very, very smart, but, you know, nobody knows because, you know, they don't have access. And so access is it. So I think that, you know, rather than to have me, in fact, you know, heard from. So I have these here kids here, in fact, you know, said that, well, you know, you guys have to in fact, address. You have to wear a certain tie to guys. Ladies have to wear a thin dress or skirt. And, in fact, none of them argue. None of them say, oh, man, that's terrible. None of them argue. They all say, great. You know, and so, you know, that is the thing. And so what I kind of would like to do, and I know that you guys, time is, in fact, very, very short, but I would like that you guys to hear for a minute for, like, some of these here kids, because they are the end, in fact, users. And I think that to hear from me and from Mr. In fact, Zimbo or the principals, but, you know, we had kind of Morgan just gave us a tremendous the offer that I will kind of share later on, because I have to talk to that my type of boss first. but anyway, I would like for that, you know, these here kids to have something. This is Opal and Albert. So Opal won the competition. She got first place. Her and also Angela. And in fact, you know, the deal is we got ourselves first, second, third, and also fourth place. But they didn't kind of want it to seem like they was trying to have it with the rubbed in. So they just said it's first, second, and third. But the reality is we got first, second, third, and also, in fact, fourth place. It was a thing, a clean sweep against the national. In fact, with the champions, wasn't even close.
I don't think I really need the mic, do I? I do? Okay.
Y'all can hear me now? All right, so I'm going to just make this really quick. My name is Albert Michelle. We have Opal Polonese, Angela Girodier, Mary Sannon, and Joaquin Pyres. Our president was supposed to come today, but she has some issues going on with the family members, so she wasn't able to make it. So practically, some of us are the original Empower Yourself members. We started in sixth grade when Mr. Turner came as a substitute teacher to North Ashfield and Plouf and started talking about this financial literacy program. Now I'm a sixth grader, I am 11 years old, and I think financial literacy, it's all money. Ooh, I'm gonna get some money, I get to spend some money, I get to have a white party like P. Diddy and enjoy everything. But it was nothing close to that at all. Empower Yourself is practically a financial literacy program that helps underprivileged youth in the community learn about financial and economic business. Because we are the future leaders of the world, we need to know how to spend our money wisely, use it in certain categories for specific things instead of spending it all willy-nilly. Because you can't go to like a regular adult right now and ask them, oh, what's a bond? What's the difference between a 401k plan and a 403b? But if you ask one of us, we'd automatically know it like that. It wouldn't be just because we just know it. It was the hard work and dedication that we put into it because of Mr. Turner. And we just like to also thank Ms. Walder because she also helped us drive even more into the program as we came into the high school. So, is there a clicker?
Yeah, it's right there.
Okay. How does this work? Okay. So I practically explained this while we were getting everything set up. Educate underserved youth in the urban communities in field of financial literacy, business, economics, so they make informed financial and economic decisions later on in the future.
Okay, so my job is to talk about why this organization is so important. A quote from Eleanor Roosevelt is, we cannot always build a future for our youth, but we can build our youth for a future. And that was such a profound quote to me, and it really stood out in many ways because it really helped me to understand the necessity of equipping the youth with the opportunities to succeed. And I think this is what this organization really does. It, like Mr. Turner made a great point earlier, we don't have the best, you know, points of access, you know, to be able to talk to CEOs like we are able to now, and or we're able to compete with schools like BLS, Boston Latin, or East Greenwich. But, you know, because of the opportunities that this program or this organization provides, we are able to. Like, I never thought that I could be seventh grade going up against high schoolers and, you know, coming in the top 10. But I did. We did. And it proved to me, to us, that we can do it. You know, we are smart kids, and if we're recognized, we can prove that.
Next slide. Yeah.
So, me personally, I joined Empower Yourself at the end of last year because I didn't know much about it. So I don't have as much experience, but to be honest, I didn't know anything about finance. I didn't really care about finance. I just was like, okay, I'm just gonna go to school, get all A's. I walked in there and I learned so much about finance and how to become financially literate. And just by that, I was hooked. And from like ever since, I think we all have put so much effort into this organization. And our experience is that it opened new opportunities for us to improve our skills. We all have individual skills that we want to obtain. But with Empower Yourself, we were able to make that skill even greater. We also have found a way to actually build our long-lasting connections with people and relationships. Within the Empower Yourself group itself, we have built so much connection with among one another. So I feel that's very important. I think that's what we all have benefited from this group.
Next one. Okay, so what Mr. Turner didn't really say was that I'm his very first. I was there from the beginning of sixth grade, that first day, the Tuesday, after school, after all my classes, waiting in that CAF, getting my little after school snacks, and then coming to the class. I was his very first. He didn't mention that, but okay, I got you, Mr. Turner. Okay, so the Empower Yourself has done many astonishing things throughout the community and the school. We have partnered with Eastern Bank, setting up giving out bags to help kids prepare for the school year. We have also partnered with United Way throughout, I think it was in the middle of the school year we were doing that. We had this coat drive where we had coats, hats, gloves, helping families and children around like the community.
So it's not something, we don't only help impact the community, but we're very grateful to be part of Brockton Public School. And we're very grateful that we had the opportunity in many cases to involve students in the school. For example, with the FBI Academy, I'll continue. With the FBI Academy, we had a chance to get a lot of people in the school actually come in and learn certain things about being an FBI agent, what it's like. It's not only that, also, we have had many luncheons with important people to give us the information that we need in order to have a successful future, or to lead us to a successful future, which is very important. And we would gladly thank the Brockton Public System, the superintendents, the principals, for making this all possible, because we all feel that's very important.
One more thing is that during our FBI Academy, we also learned something very important. Some kids did not know that if you test drugs or illegal illegal drinking alcohol, that can stay in your system and that could prevent you from getting a job that you really wanted. When we heard that, we were like, oh, okay, no more doing that, right? We are helping ourselves. These people coming in, teaching us things that we didn't even know that could prevent us from actually becoming an agent further on. So the Empower Yourself has taught us many great things, and that's pretty much it. Inspired us.
Before we close up, can we get the middle school kids up here too? Because it's not just us, it's also them, because they're future kids.
Jordan.
Hmm?
No, Jordan, are you a part of this? Come.
We'd like to present you this evening with a couple of certificates. As you can see, we're very proud of all the work
that you have accomplished. So let's kind of squeeze in here. I know you've already shouted out to your principals. I know Principal Barbara Lovell is here in the audience, Principal Sharon Wolder, and I know Shauna Hearn, and I see teachers out there. I could see your smiling faces when they were presenting. I know how you've supported them along the way, so thank you.
So we would like to award
some certificates of recognition to the Empower Yourself program at North Middle School for a depth of knowledge in finance and economics and an outstanding achievement at the Global Economic Issues Symposium at Bridgewater State University. So, who is here from North Middle School?
No.
Any students from North Middle School?
We'll give that to Mr. Turner. Too.
Okay, we'll give that to Mr. Okay. Turner.
Bring it over there to North.
Okay, and I know that Principal Lovell is here, so we have a certificate of recognition for the Ashfield School, Middle School, so I'll give that to Mr. Turner. Is someone here from Ashfield?
Oh,
there's a good
sign. Great. Okay, hi. So this is for you and to give to Principal Lovell. Congratulations. And then we also have one for Brockton High School, and I know that Principal Wolder is here.
Yes.
And
she's trying to hide.
She,
no, I represent.
You can't hide.
So this is for you, and you can give that to Principal Wolder.
Thank you so much.
You go that way.
Congratulations, Mrs. Wolder.
Thank you so much. Thank
you. You should really announce this tomorrow.
Great.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Congratulations. Well done.
And I will tell you, when I spent last Thursday at the high school talking to my sophomore listening tour, Youth Voices, one of the first questions they asked also was about the budget. I'd like to put them on, I think, our task force with the budget. And they wanted to make sure that they got the word out there. They talked about advocacy, and before we left there, they were going to get back to me about ways that they could talk about their education and what they would like to see the community support. So thank you again. I don't think you could find a more determined, dedicated group, and I guess I want to thank all of those involved. Good.
Yeah, I mean, Mr. Turner certainly is a wonderful mentor, and you, all the students are certainly fortunate to have him, and you know, his energy and his effort to expose you all to different experiences and to different companies and businesses that you ordinarily wouldn't have the opportunity to attend. What's so important is how well you all presented yourself. I'm very impressed with, you know, your language, your speech, your mannerisms, your considerate and polite demeanors, and that is going to take you all very far in life. Just remember, when you are all very successful in life, don't forget where you come from. So when you have the opportunity to work at one of those big companies, Morgan Stanley, Deloitte Touche, Brown Brothers, and Harriman, you don't forget the Brockton Public Schools, and remember to provide opportunities for your fellow classmates who are following in your footsteps. You're going to make us all very proud, because I can tell that you are all on a pathway to success. Certainly from your presentation this evening, the sky is the limit. So thank you all so much.
Good. And let me move on before we do our last presentations. When you talk about these kinds of programs, I want to bring to your attention, I know it was in your packet, that today, and I believe on Thursday, we have CNN filming at our own East Middle School about a program called Coaching for Change that we have at East. Marquise Taylor is our director of that program, and they are looking to highlight programs that are supporting youngsters. They're considered doing extraordinary things for others. So I know there's a blackout until they actually present this, but Tuesday and Thursday of this week, we have CNN here filming again. Our students and people from the community willing to support our kids so that they can be all that that they can. So.
Coming.
I don't think Anderson Cooper is on site, but I believe he does. I think he does head up this program.
Wow, impressive.
Couldn't make it?
I couldn't.
It's his loss. Okay, and I'd like to bring up Laurie Mason, our Director of Special Education. As you know, our new school committee members, we continue to bring departments to update you on the things happening in the district. This is usually one of those presentations that elicits many, many questions. Again, it's a program that we're very proud of and certainly accommodates many of our students. Our assistant director, Olga Grigge, is also joining her this evening, so thank you. And I believe you have a PowerPoint, so we'll...
Yep, Hi, I'm Laurie Mason, the Director of Special Ed, and Olga Garriga, my Assistant Director. Thank you. Oh, you can't hear me? Oh, sorry. I usually have a very loud voice, so I don't usually need a microphone, but thank you for having us tonight. So we want to share a little bit about our Special Education Department. We look at four of areas that we feel are really important in special education: programming, compliance, support, and communication. So we're going to talk a little bit about the demographics. Right now, as of February 1st, there were 17,540 students in the Brockton Public Schools, 2,597 students were students with disabilities. The average, our percentage is 14.8%. The state average is 17.2%. Looking at the other urban districts, the other eight or nine that we look at, Brockton, it has the lowest percentage of students with disabilities in Massachusetts. All right, so when we look at program considerations, we look at Child Find, servicing students 3 to 22 with varying disabilities, our post-grad programs, our continuum of services, and our out-of-district placements. So Child Find, it's our responsibility to provide parents with information for them to come to us if they feel like their child may have a disability. How we do this is we have a put an ad in the paper to talk about if they want their child to be evaluated. I also send letters to the private schools in the Brockton area and outside of Brockton if they have students from Brockton attending. It's really important that this is a state mandate that it's our responsibility to reach out to those communities and those schools. And we also have a really strong connection with early intervention. I'm stumbling. So the Brockton Public Schools has special ed programs in the following disability areas. We feel really good about what we do in Brockton for special ed. I think as Kathy Smith mentioned earlier, we do have families that move to Brockton for our special education programs. Our programs are geared to individualizing the programs. We look at the academic, social, and behavioral needs of all students. We look at formal and informal observations and data collection. All our programs use a multi-sensory approach, and they're presented to individual students, small and large groups. We have staff-student ratios that are really work well with students, and they're depending on those staff assistants for repetition and reinforcement to teach those skills to the students.
It's important to note that in terms of compliance, there are state mandates that talk about the number of special education students that can be within each program. So we have to be very cognizant of the programming and how many students we have in each one of our classrooms in order to meet the state compliance for grouping sizes.
All our programs are structured, consistent, and have systematic approaches to learning. Accommodations are interwoven in the classroom. We utilize effective practices and strategies. Our curriculum is aligned to the district and Common Core. And we have inclusive opportunities, a structure for each student based on the student's area of strength and need. We also have, on an individual basis, IEP teams determine if a student should participate in on-demand statewide assessment with accommodation or alternative statewide assessments. In our special education programs, there are students who are taking MCAS and PAC with accommodations, and then we have a population of students who do the portfolio assessment. And it's important to mention that students that are on the portfolio assessment, we provide teachers with an MCAS, what we call MCAS alt coach. They're working directly with the teachers. They're going into the classrooms. We provide trainings for the teachers to make sure that we are meeting the requirements for that portfolio assessment.
Were also tied into the compliance. So. One important concept is what is called the least restrictive environment. So we must maintain students in general education as much as possible and adjust the curriculum. That's why the curriculum is aligned to the Common Core, because as much as possible, we must ensure that students are taught in general ed and that the services provided are in addition to what the teacher is providing in the gen ed classroom.
We have our post-grad programs, so the students at Brockton High, students with disabilities are able to go to school until they turn the age of 22. So we have students that will go attend graduation, receive a certificate of completion, and then return back to Brockton and really focus on transition and working towards independence. And we have a lot of programs that we have the kids involved with at Brockton High. This is a program, the post-grad program, we've really worked on over the past few years. Diane Davis, the department at Brockton High, working really closely with Sharon Walder to make sure that we're providing these kids with other opportunities, because they've gone to graduation, they've walked across, they've received a diploma. Now we need to teach them, because we're still responsible for providing them with education. So we've really worked really hard over the past couple of years to make this a strong program, and we continue to work on it. We provide a continuum of services in the Brockton Public Schools, where we have kids that are just receiving related services, which would be speech, occupational therapy, physical therapy. And then our services, they continue in the gen ed classroom. We have integrated programs. We have substantially separate programs for students with different types of disabilities. Then we have a public day school, which is our guarded school, which we have had a lot of success at the guarded school. The teachers over there are working hard, just as all our Brockton teachers are. Then we have students who are at home and hospital. They're in the hospital. We have to provide instruction for them also. And then we have our out-of-district placements. So we have about 125 students currently in an out-of-district placement. In 2013 to present, we've had 12 students return to the Brockton Public Schools. They have made enough progress to come back to the district. A lot of parents want their kids back in the Brockton Public Schools to continue their education. Projected for next year, we're hoping to bring back 8 additional students, which is exciting. And this year was a little different for us. When we had 4 students at our public day school who moved out of Brockton, but districts wanted them to continue, and obviously we wanted them to continue in our day program too. So the communities tuitioned their kids back into Brockton, so we were able to have 4 students who were at the guarded school continue, and actually one is going to be graduating, so that's very exciting for him. So the second part of our job is compliance. That's what we do every day at the special education department. So when we look at, we broke the compliance down to a couple different areas. So our job is to make sure when we ensure timelines for the team process, that we're providing parents with the consents in a timely manner, that we're contacting parents to talk to them about what the assessments would look like, that we complete the assessments on time. There's a timeline that when we receive a letter from a parent or we're having a we want to have testing done, that the parents get the consent within a certain amount of time, that we complete the assessments in time. We provide the parents with those assessments 2 days before their team meeting, that we hold the team meeting between 30 and 45 school days of signing that consent. During that team meeting, we determine if their child is eligible for special education. And we go through the IEP process. We generate progress reports once the student is on an IEP to show what the progress is, and we do that at the report card time. So if a student's getting a report card, we also provide them with a progress report to show how they're progressing towards their goals and objectives. Our job is to address parent requests and their concerns, and our main job is that we follow all the safeguards. So this is just the one piece of our job for the team process, that if any one of these falls out of the window of the timelines, we're out of compliance. So we really work hard to make sure that we're providing parents with all the information they need and following the timelines as the state and federal guidelines determine. We also have compliance with new regulations. We have the new discipline law, the new restraint policy. We went through a coordinated program review, and then we have some non-compliance. So I want to go back to the new discipline law. We've worked really hard with our special ed attorney who's come to the district and has met with not only the special education department, but has also worked with the principals and worked closely with the executive team to make sure that we're understanding the discipline law and that we're following it. And if we do have any questions, she's there to consult and to advise us to make sure that we're making all doing what we're supposed to be doing. The new restraint policy, we decided to have a group of people be our point people. They've gone to trainings outside of the district. They're working closely with the Department of Ed. They've put together a PowerPoint presentation to talk about the restraint policy and training and working with principals and buildings and teachers and staff to make sure that everybody understands that new policy that's put in place. This year we've undergone a coordinated program review, so that's from the Department of Ed comes out. They came out in September and reviewed special education folders to make sure that we're in compliance and following all the timelines and looking at all the compliance issues around special education evaluations. And they also came back in October and did school visits and interviews with parents, teachers, principals. And they really looked at our district to determine, are we in compliance with what we're supposed to be as far as special education, civil rights, and our vocational component. We just received our report probably a month ago. So we now have to look at what we need to work on. And we have what we call progress reports for DESE too. So they've given us their timelines of when we need to come back and fix or update what we need to do. I feel that our coordinated program, we had a great team from the Department of Ed come out. They answered a lot of our questions and they were there for us to give us some technical assistance. Do you want to add anything else about So when we talk about compliance, there's also the other side of the coin, which is the non-compliance. And this is where if parents feel that their children have not received what they need to receive, there are different avenues for parents to look at non-compliance. So PQA is Program Quality Assurance, which is linked to the Department of Ed. So if parents have issues with anything related to their child's education, well, we hope that they come to us first. So we are their first line of defense, but we have to provide them with other avenues. And so they can call Program Quality Assurance, and then they can talk to the person about, you know, if they have issues, and then they'll call us, and so we can see if we can resolve them. The BSEA is a Bureau of Special Education Appeals, where parents, that's where we really look at the student's IEP. If parents are not happy with that, that's their avenue to talk to a mediator or a hearing officer to talk about what they feel the district's not providing as far as the IEP. The Office for Civil Rights, if parents have that avenue if they feel that their child's civil rights are being violated, and then the Department of Justice.
So these are all different departments that parents can reach out to and for whom we have to respond. So if a complaint is filed with PQA, we have to do an investigation and write a thorough report and provide copies of our investigation to both the parent and the Department of Education. And then they, in turn, determine whether the district has met compliance or not and what actions need to occur. So those are the kinds of things that we're constantly reviewing.
And our main job is is compliance, so we really work hard in our department to make sure that everything's in play. So if a parent does have an issue or concern, that we're the first line of defense because we want to make sure that they're getting their child what they need. Okay, so I'm not going to read this whole thing, but there is a Massachusetts State Performance Plan. So other than the compliance for team meetings and the other new regulations that we have to follow, we have indicators that are identified by the Federal Office of Special Education. So each state has a 6-year strategic plan, and then each district has to answer to each one of the indicators. All the indicators are linked to compliance, and the districts are assigned by cohorts and indicators. So Brockton is in cohort 2. So they'll do 4 years of indicators that Brockton would need to provide data for. So for example, in 2014-15, we had to provide data to the Department of Ed on our initial evaluation timelines. So we have information that we have to share with them. They analyze it and then come back and say, they may ask other questions to us about, so last year we had a lot of snow days. So our timelines may have been a little off because school was canceled and then the team meetings would be rescheduled and then we'd have another snow day. So the timelines may be off a little bit for that. But though that was one of our indicators. So Department of Ed looks at, is Brockton following all the evaluation timelines? Another one of our indicators was post-school outcomes. They wanted us to identify, and this is a 2-year indicator to look at kids after graduation. What, you know, we're looking at, we developed a student profile because this year we need to find out what are they doing after graduation? Are kids being successful? Are they going to school? You know, we don't want kids to graduate and sit on the couch. We want to be able to help them to find, like, what are their next steps, and we do have resources for that. Early childhood outcomes, we have entry and exit data collection that we're doing for early childhood, and that will continue in 2016 and then again in 2017. So next year we also have secondary transition and the following a parent involvement survey in early childhood. So the state of Massachusetts looks at a 4-year span and identifies indicators based on what cohort the district's in, and then we have to provide data to the Department of Ed.
And what's important to note here is the Department of Ed expects perfect data. So we have to not only gather the data and analyze the data, if we find on our end that we are lacking in a particular point, we have to rectify it immediately, provide training so that we can ensure that it doesn't happen in the future, so that moving forward, when we present the data to them, the data is perfect.
And I just wanted to give you an example of the other things for compliance. So our indicators are all compliance related. Next school year, we have to work on our program plan for special education, and that is really to ensure that the special ed department is informing the district and the principals and executive team of what we're doing in special education, and we're going to go through that process next year. And the Department of Ed gives us a format to follow. It's just to make sure that everybody is understanding of the laws and regulations surrounding special education. Okay, so one of our next focus is eligibility. We make sure that we follow the state guidelines. that we're instituting instructional support teams at our buildings to really look at building-based teams are talking about kids and what we're doing to help kids struggling learners and how we're responding. We look at interventions and working with the special education departments, working with the general ed population and building teams to make sure that we're providing them with enough support for students during that eligibility process. We follow the state disability definitions for eligibility is dictated by the Massachusetts. We have to make sure we have enough documentation to show that we're linking the eligibility with documentation, and that our testing, that we have appropriate testing and assessment. So when we look at the eligibility criteria, that we're following exactly what the state, it's scripted from the Department of Ed, Massachusetts. Okay, our next area of support, we work really closely with Gen Ed to provide trainings and workshops to not only special education staff, but general ed staff. We do a lot of professional development. I have a professional development grant that from the Department of Ed that really wants districts to work with all staff, Gen Ed or special ed, for a common goal. Our department works. We attend regularly scheduled meetings with building administrators. We work with them. We do a lot of consultation. We do a lot of case reviews with building principals and building-based teams. And then we provide parent workshops. And then our communication, we have an open door policy. We want parents to call us. We encourage that if parents are having difficulty and need us to help them guide them. Sometimes parents will call us about school-based issues, so we work closely with the schools to make sure that we're all on the same page and helping parents to understand the process. I think a lot of our communication with parents is understanding the process. They'll request an evaluation but really don't know what that means. So we have people, you know, Olga and I spend a lot of time working with parents and facilitating.
Answering questions.
We make sure that all our communications are provided in the native language. We did a workshop last year and we had multi languages. And we had parents it was great because Olga's fluent in Spanish and we had someone who spoke Haitian Creole and
Portuguese.
So we and I obviously only speak English, so I was the English speaking. So we did a nice presentation on parents' rights, and so that was nice to have that in the native languages. We always encourage our teachers to have that homeschool connection, that they're communicating with parents daily or weekly to make sure that parents understanding what's happening with their child in special ed. I think that's really important. I think when parents don't know what's happening or not understanding what is happening, that's when they have a lot of questions and get frustrated. It's just like when you're on an airport and you're in the plane and the plane's not moving and no one's telling you why the plane's not moving and all you need to know is just tell me what's happening, then you feel a lot better. That's how I sometimes see parents just want answers to some of their questions. They want to know what their kids are doing in school. And I think that's our mantra with our teachers, communication with the parents, whether it's, like I said, a weekly note or a daily note to parents. It's just, it's really important. It's important on both sides, too.
Okay.
I know we went that really fast, so.
Okay.
You don't have to clap. No clapping. No clapping. Oh, any questions? Oh, I'm good. Any questions?
Okay. Make a comment, excuse me, to the special ed department. I do foster care, and a couple of my kids are in special ed right now, and they're doing very good. Special ed in Brockton has come a long way. When I adopted my son quite a few years ago, special ed was horrible here. West Junior High, the special ed class was actually a closet. Okay, when my son came here to the high school, the paraprofessionals in the classroom would read the newspaper and not help the kids. It has come a long way, I will say, but the school system also has failed my son, and I don't know how many other kids that went through the system before. But you have come a long way.
You have the right at the beginning of every meeting to sign in at the hearing of visitors, and if you'd like to do that at the next meeting, that would be fine.
Oh, I've never been to these meetings. I just can't because of my daughter here. But they're talking about special ed, and there was a problem with special ed. I want people to know that.
Okay.
It wasn't always like this. It has come a long way.
Okay, and we appreciate your support, but we do have procedures, and so if you would like to, you know, basically again attend the next meeting and sign in, we'd love to hear your comments. If you would like to meet with any of the school committee members after the meeting, we'd love to have a conversation with you, or certainly the superintendent. So we're glad to hear that things are improving in your eyes, but we can't have everyone from the audience. I know, but I'm just saying we have to follow our protocols, so to speak. So, but thank you for attending. So, are there any comments or questions from the members? Lisa, did you have a question or comment?
Are you usually already aware of students when they come in, get registered? Are they already on an IEP? Are you already aware? And how often are you finding that out once they're enrolled?
So we work very closely with the Parent Information Center. So if parents register their child and say that their child's on an IEP, the Parent Information Center gathers all that information and then brings they actually literally walk across the street, bring the folder to Olga or myself, and we review the folder. We reach out right out to the parent, ask to come in for an intake. If it's a child we have to place in special ed, we call the previous school district to get as much information as we can. And the process is pretty tight. So we get the folder, and we're immediate within 24 to 48 hours, we're having the parents in, and we're placing students if it's a special ed student we need to place. Sometimes parents don't always share the information that their child's on an IEP till once they're already in the school. So our job is to really, if they tell the school later, oh, my child's on an IEP, we will reach out to the previous district to get as much information as we can. Yeah.
And I think that's all. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you.
Mr. DeAgostino?
If a parent wanted to have their student evaluated, how does that process get started? What would they do to initiate that process?
So if they share, they always can call the special education department, but a lot of times parents will feel more comfortable with sharing, asking a teacher at the school level, I want my child to be evaluated. We usually typically tell them to write a letter. A parent can call right directly to the special education department and request that eval. We always have someone will call back the parent to say, what are your concerns? We want to make sure that we're doing the evaluation in the right areas. We have the conversation with the parent first, and then we send out an evaluation consent form. We mail it right out to the parent, explaining what that is, what they need to do, and sign it. And we kind of go through the timelines of right. What it would look like.
Okay, so the first point of contact is a written letter to your office.
We have a lot of people that come in and say, I want my child evaluated, they're having problems, and we immediately meet with them and typically have them write a letter.
Okay, great,
then it's
thank
just,
you.
You know, documentation for us,
excellent.
Too. Yeah.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Lori, you mentioned that there's approximately 125 out-of-district placements.
Yes.
Can you just inform the committee and the public, God bless you, what the range of some of those disabilities would be, for what would warrant an out-of-district placement, what types of situations that encompasses?
Well, Olga was the out-of-district coordinator before she became the assistant director, so she can speak to a lot to that.
So out-of-district placements occur sometimes when we have disabilities that are what we consider low incidence, so that we don't have too many students with that disability within the age span, so we don't have creative programs. Students with vision impairments that require specialized instruction that we can't provide, or sometimes students with hearing impairments are also placed in out-of-district programs. The hearing population is one that we're looking to bring back some of our younger students and create a program for. So we have those low incidence disabilities. We also have students who have not been successful within our programs, who are not making progress and require sometimes smaller, even smaller programs, or a different kind of setting or environment that we have not been successful in providing, and those students end up out of district. And sometimes we have students that move in without a district IEPs, and we must implement the IEP that has moved in. And usually when we have those students coming in, what we do is, you know, they stay in their program, we have meetings in their programs, and we determine, do we have a program within the Brockton Public Schools that the student can then transition to for the next school year? But sometimes, you know, those affect our out-of-district numbers.
I think over the past few years, we are always looking at our out-of-district students to see if we can provide the program within the district. I think, what did I say, 2013 to present, we brought back 12 students, which was great, and all are doing well. And as Olga had mentioned, next year I want to bring back 3 hearing-impaired students and create a program in the Brockton Public Schools. Because they're in kindergarten, so they're only 5 years old. So if you're looking at, you know, bringing them back to Brockton, and their parents want them to go to school in Brockton. So we are always evaluating our students in our out-of-district placements to determine whether or not the out-of-district placement needs to continue or do they come back to the Brockton Public Schools.
What are some of the costs of some of the programs? Costs? The range goes
from anywhere from
60,000 to, you know,
200,000.
Yeah, 200,000. For some of the residential.
And then we have to look at, you know, transportation also.
Right.
I just want to talk a little bit about bringing those little guys back. So it takes, I've been talking about this for 3 years. Because when you have students that are in out-of-district programs and we want to bring them back, we have to let the parents know that they're going to get the same quality education in their in-district program as they're getting in their out-of-district program. And sometimes that takes a lot of time to do. So since I became the director in 2013, I've been talking about bringing this population of students back. You have to make sure you have a teacher of the deaf. You have to make sure you have ASL interpreters. You have to make sure you have a building that's conducive to students with hearing issues. So we're able to do that. It's taken a couple of years, but we're able to do that. I already have a teacher of the deaf already working in the city, and we already have a space that would be really conducive to bringing these kids back. And there are 3 other students already in the district, so that classroom would have 6 or 7 students starting in September. So it is a process, and you really have to make sure that what we have in district is comparable to what they have out of district to make sure that the parents are comfortable with that decision. Parents want their kids in the Brockton Public Schools. They want them back with their friends. They want them to make those connections.
Have to create a quality program.
Right, and that's our goal.
Offer them.
And we're working on that.
So at the end of each year, what is the process in terms of the out-of-district students? So right now there's 125. Does someone have the task of reviewing each file, or how does that work to try to figure out if there can be some return students?
We meet monthly with the out-of-district. So Olga and myself meet with the out-of-district coordinator monthly, and we review cases. Michelle Lanner is the current out-of-district coordinator. She was a department head in the Brockton Public Schools. She knows the programs. So when she's at meetings and running meetings, she's always thinking about, can I bring this child back? Do we have a program that's going to meet this child's needs? We have our own department heads going to visit the programs, observing the students all the time. And so that's an ongoing process. So each month we meet and talk about who are we looking at to come back? Because when you have students out of district, you just can't say they're coming back. It's a process. You have to reevaluate them, make sure that they're ready to come back. Like we said, it's making sure looking at the programming. But we do review it every month. And at the end of the year, I mean, I feel good that we've brought back that many students. And I'm really excited about next year because we have 8 students that we're working towards bringing back. So we tell the parents, Michelle Lanner is at the team. She talks about we want to bring your child back to the district. This is what the process is going to be. But Olga and I are constantly meeting with Michelle to review those cases.
you know, we, as you know, are going into the budget season, mm-hmm. and you know, we've seen in terms of monies being awarded to the city a very modest increase from the state. With respect to some of these out of district vendors, each year I would assume that the cost goes up. Mm-hmm. I mean, is there any containment, or are these vendors free to charge an increase whatever they want? Or? Okay.
Yeah, in order to for there to be a rate increase, the vendor has to apply to the Department of Education and demonstrate why there needs to be an increase in their rate. So not all programs are increasing their rates every year.
Well, that makes me feel better. Great. Mr. DeAgostino?
Do we get grant money to help fund some of these programs?
The out-of-district programs?
Any of the special education programs, both out-of-district or in?
Out-of-district is a separate budget. You can't use grant money to fund out-of-district programs.
Okay.
Our in-district programs that we have grant money for, we use it to purchase curriculum, we're looking at salaries, program development. But grant money is always limited, too, because, you know.
Kind of like what they gave it to you.
Yeah, they give us, you know,
right.
There's a formula that they use to figure out communities, urban communities versus suburban, and how much money they get.
Right.
So the federal government gives the state of Massachusetts a certain amount of money, and then they determine how much each district, you know, gets. I was at a meeting today, and I was hoping, you know, they're looking at hopefully level funding our grants, but it depends on how much, they don't know how much money they're getting yet.
It's part of our foundation formula.
Yes.
There is something called circuit breaker, however, and the circuit breaker is, there's also a formula there that the state determines a certain percentage of the costs of the out-of-district programs that we do get reimbursement for, but that varies depending on the state monies.
In most communities, it can be a budget breaker because you can from September to June and not know five children could move into the district without a district placement. So we have to be very, very careful. And again, mm-hmm. this is just not Brockton. This is certainly all the surrounding towns, cities.
Yes. Absolutely.
It's something that we have to plan for ahead.
I consider myself very fiscally responsible in special education. I am always looking at out-of-district placements. I'm always looking at the special education funding. I really, you know, try to look at all our resources to make sure that our job is to provide students with disabilities with a free, appropriate public education. That's what our job is. But I'm very fiscally responsible to make sure that we're looking at the funds are going to special education, and also there's a percentage of money that can go to the general ed population too. But out of district isn't, it's costly. But we are continually analyzing, you know, that information. And once students are out of district, and we're talking about middle school and high school students, it's hard to say to a parent, we're going to bring, you know, your child back if they've been out for a number of years, because they feel comfortable in that placement and their child is being successful. But we do have students that are out of district who are not successful. So our job is to make sure to find out why and try to say, okay, let's maybe we can bring those students back. They'll be more successful in the Brockton Public Schools.
Just to piggyback on Mr. DeAgostino, the grants, is that a combination between your department and the grants office, or is it just your department for special ed, or in terms of trying to find grants for special ed?
Oh, we're always looking for more grants for special education. Whether it's, I mean, there are grants that the Department of Ed is, you know, there are certain grants that come right to special education, but we're always looking for grants through the grant department and ourselves, always.
Now, not just that, the one thing I'll say in the district is special education talks to bilingual education,
yes.
talks to the grant writers, talks to community mm-hmm. schools. I mean, there's an effort out there. There is excellent mm-hmm. communication, and pretty much mm-hmm. we will vet any grant that comes through. Through our teaching and learning office, through, open communication about going after grants that we consider to support our youngsters in a number of the different departments.
And we're always looking, I mean, we're hoping that we get the same, you know, that we're level funded for our grants also, but it really depends. And they're looking at providing suburban communities more funding because the thought is that urbans have always had a lot more money than the suburban communities. So we never know. We're always hoping that we get the same level funding, but sometimes, you know, they're looking at other communities and saying they haven't had this opportunity. So maybe we'll give the money to a smaller community, which hurts urban communities. Because we build our programs, you know, as we work really hard to make sure our special education programs are in a really good place, and we use grant money to do that, to support the programs. I think as Olga said previously, we do have, our special ed programs have really high student staff ratio. That's why they're successful. That's where we have people calling our office from all communities. We haven't moved to Brockton yet, but can you tell me about, will my child be able to be in this program? They come here because of special ed programs. So I get a little nervous when we talk about funding, not with it. This group can't control that, because if our grants are cut even a 1%, it could impact our programs, and that makes me a little nervous.
Any other questions or comments? Thank you for a great
presentation.
Okay,
thank you.
The other thing before they leave, I want to comment on the special education department. We have a lot of high needs as far as staffing. And one of the things that I think our special education department does well is you have monitor teacher assistants that you have in your schools. Many times there are certainly people with bachelor's degrees. Some have certifications, might be in elementary education. There isn't a job. One of the things we've done well is if, in fact, they're placed in a number of our special education classes, we have seen mentoring, encouragement. Mm-hmm. So when you talk about districts struggling, and we continue to struggle, believe me, but I think we do a really good job of many of our hires, certainly over my past 3 years, our teachers that have come through the system have been encouraged to go on, get those certifications and licensures, and have already had real experience
yes.
in some of our classrooms, supporting our classrooms. So,
that's a really good
you.
Point. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. And our last group, I'm going to ask Deputy Superintendent Barry to come up with her team. I had told you at the last school committee meeting we would give you an update on Park transitioning into our MCAS 2.0 in the next couple of years. I believe she's bringing her Park fellows, Eileen McQuaid and Dr. Heather Ronan, who will update you as far as what's happening district-wide and talk about the movement in the state.
Good evening. As Superintendent Smith said, we have a team approach in doing this presentation. I'm going to introduce a couple of people to you. I have to my far left Eileen McQuaid. She's the coordinator of English Language Arts and Social Sciences for 612 and the alternative schools. Next to me is Heather Ronan. She is the coordinator of math and science pre-K to 5. In addition to everything that they do to support our schools in Brockton, they both are Park Fellows for the state of Massachusetts and have had that role for 3 years now. Missing one. There we go. Okay. So what you have in front of you is a timeline that really illustrates Massachusetts' path and plan towards a next generation assessment. As you can see, it leads to a very ambitious goal of having all students participate in a computer-based test in 2019. The timeline has gone through several revisions over time, and we expect that it will be revised again. But if you look at where we are today, this past fall, the Board of Elementary and Secondary Education voted to adopt a next generation assessment that they're calling MCAS 2.0. The original choice was, does the state adopt PARC? And they made a decision to consider a test which is a hybrid of our MCAS test as well as the PARC test, which we had been piloting over the last couple of years. Go back.
So a few of the more concrete differences between MCAS and PARC. In MCAS, the testing windows, ELA was given usually in March and April, and then math and science was given in May. The testing window for PARC, the ELA, math, and science are given in May. It actually starts the last week in April for the computer-based schools. The computer-based schools have a little bit of a longer window to accommodate the devices. But what the major difference here, and if you talk to teachers in grades 3, 4, and 5, 6, 7, and 8, what they'll really echo is having the window in May has freed up March and April for instruction and for teaching, which we've never had before. Another major difference between MCAS and PARC is that MCAS is not timed, and so students can have the entire day to finish the test and finish each unit of the test. The PARC assessment is timed. Each session is between 60 minutes and 110 in ELA. Some of the math sessions are as little as 60 minutes, and sessions are not timed for ELL and SPED students.
Some other differences. A similarity, though, for both is that the MCAS test and the PARC test both have a written response component and a selected response component. So if we look at MCAS, you can see that for many years, students were asked to write open responses. They would read a text, and they would respond to a question on that text. And then they had a longer composition that they had to do in ELA for grades 4, 7, and 10 only. This long composition was usually based upon a question that was not text-based. So things like in grade 4, they would have to write a story based upon tell me the story of a snow day, for example, and the student would write a narrative. And then in grade 7, they would write an expository essay, tell me who's your hero and explain why. Then in grade 10, they would have to think about a book that they read, and they would have to answer a question like, the main character had to overcome a conflict. Think about a book that you've read and explain how that character overcame that conflict. That's kind of like a literary analysis without actually having the text in front of you. And so, and you'll also notice that open responses were given at every grade, but the long composition just in 4, 7, and 10. So PARC is asking for more. For math, the open responses are no longer there. They're called various performance tasks. These performance tasks could be multi-step, and they are tasks that really assess conceptual understanding that students have for math. Do you want to say anything else about that, Heather?
Just watching you talk about math,
it's fun.
So in math, there are three different types of questions that students might be asked, and part of those tasks would be not just to be able to assess their conceptual understanding, but they would also possibly have to critique the reasoning of others in a particular scenario based on the math practices, or model with mathematics. So they really have to demonstrate their knowledge of the mathematics. So it's beyond being able to calculate and to being able to understand.
So you'll also see for the ELA side for PARC, it's ELA in literacy, and so students, they'll have to write narratives, but every grade, not just grade 4, will have to write in a narrative. And what the students will do is they'll read a story, and then they'll have to write their own original story where they're changing the end of the story, or they'll continue the story, things of that nature. Then there's a literary analysis task. These are very similar to the old open responses that you had with MCAS. MCAS, students would read a text and have to answer a question based upon that text. But now they've upped the game where the students are having to write these essays on two texts instead of one. And then finally, you have an analysis of three informational texts, and that ups the ante even more. They're reading complex informational texts, and then they have to synthesize information in order and use evidence in order to answer that. So what you'll see is that the written responses, different from MCAS, is that they're really focusing on synthesis of multiple texts, using evidence from texts, and these are considered very important college and career-ready skills that students were not assessed on the previous MCAS test. And that brings us to the next kind of response that students have to give, which is a selected response. With MCAS, it's very typical, multiple choice with four choices, A through D, and there was always one right answer. And the student could sometimes be lucky and guess and get it right. With PARC, they're really thinking about reasoning and being able to support claims that you have. I claim that this is the correct answer, and having evidence to support that claim. So how do they do that? Very often, and in ELA more often than not, they have a two-part question, and it's an evidence-based question. Part A, a question that could have as many as seven choices and could even have more than one right answer. If you were in ELA, you could say, what would be two themes from this text? The student would pick two themes, and then they would say, now in the second part, a question that asks for evidence to support the answer in part A. Give me two pieces of evidence from the text to support each of those themes. So notice how that takes the element of guessing away, and it also makes the student accountable for being able to justify his claims when he's making with evidence, when he's saying that this is the correct answer. So the stakes are much higher, as you can see on the right hand side of that chart with PARC, and you can see the direct connection that they have to college and career readiness. And one more thing, MCAS is on paper and PARC eventually will be on computer in 2019. That's their goal.
And it will be called MCAS 2.0. So clever. Okay, so there actually are districts in the state of Massachusetts who are still giving MCAS. One of the choices that the Board of Elementary and Secondary Education made, one of the decisions that they made, was that districts that were giving MCAS and had yet to actually give the PARC test could still give MCAS this year. So you will see that there are some districts within the state that are hanging on to MCAS as an assessment. As a PARC district in our we've been consistently sort of moving in that direction, and the decision for us this year was simply we had to go with PARC because that's something that we had committed to doing, but did we have the option to actually bring more schools to the computer-based test? And unfortunately, our fiscal situation didn't allow us to expand in Brockton to adding computer-based schools. So this year, our spring 2016 testing, we have all schools be taking PARC for math and ELA and literacy. We have the five schools that took the test on the computer last year taking the test on the computer this year. That's the Hancock, Downey, Huntington, Raymond, and Ashfield, and all of the other schools will be testing on paper. All schools will be taking MCAS for science, and that occurs in just grades 5 and 8. And then for grades 9 through 12, Brockton High School will continue to give MCAS for math, ELA, and science.
So we're continuing on to MCAS 2.0, and this year the Department of Education is moving in that direction. They're in the process of gathering committees and upgrading MCAS so that it better measures those critical skills that we talked about for college and career readiness in the 21st century. And as Liz pointed out, the very inventive name is MCAS 2.0, and it'll build upon the best aspects of the old MCAS assessments, and it'll also include innovative items from PARC. So we're still part of the PARC consortium, and so we can still we have access to all of the items that PARC has created over the past 2 years.
MCAS 2.0 will be designed to be taken on the computer, although we will still have many students taking the paper and pencil version. The timeline for that is a bit ambitious, but the Department of Ed is aiming for 2019. And then Massachusetts will have complete control over test administration, test content, testing windows, and the reporting of results. That was one of the major reasons why the board decided to do this hybrid, so that they can have complete control over the test. And Eileen and I, as Park Fellows, as well as because of our knowledge and involvement in curriculum, we were asked to be part of a committee that will provide input on these state decisions. So we will still continue to not only be Park Fellows and continue that work, but we've also been asked to be part of the process of this Massachusetts controlled test. So.
In your Friday packet this past week, we included some parent resources for your use. You can actually find those parent resources on our website. They are in the parents, they're under the parents and community page under a button called state assessment. So the resources that you received on paper are also available right on our website as well.
The committee is Plant.
If we're looking at this paper that tells us MCAS versus PARC, which ones are you incorporating? You say that the MCAS 2.0 is going to be the best of both tests. Could you tell us which ones, just looking at this chart here, that they are going to?
They're in the process, and that's what these committees are set up on to do, and Heather and I are both going to sort of work on these committees, but as of right now, no decisions have been made, and we'll let you know as soon as we know.
Mm-hmm. The chart is indicating MCAS as we've known it in the past. That
yes.
has been the existing MCAS. MCAS 2.0, we are being told, is going to be much more PARC-like with the same types of tasks and questions and rigor. Massachusetts is responsible for writing, Ethan, correct me if I'm wrong, over 50% of the questions that were being denied from the PAR consortium were from Massachusetts, and they were being pushed back in because Massachusetts was insisting that the rigor matched our standards here in Massachusetts. So,
did they say whether it will be timed? Is that a decision that's been made?
It hasn't been made.
Nothing's
yet.
Been decided.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
A couple things. You had mentioned there were committees which you all were invited to be a part of, and you may have said this, and I just didn't catch it, but the committees, are there classroom teachers who are actually still in the classroom being allowed to participate this time?
Yes.
And
excellent.
There were classroom teachers involved last time when they created PARC as well.
Okay.
And our, as PARC Fellows, is a mixture of curriculum coordinators, teachers, special ed teachers, building-based administrators. It's a very eclectic group.
Runs the gamut.
Great.
I don't believe every district has PARC Fellows. We're very fortunate to have two. I don't want you to think that every district does have the certainly the seat at the table that we've had.
That brings up another question. What exactly does that mean that you're a PARC Fellow? What
other than having a really charming name. the PARC Fellow was, was it 3 years ago, they put out to all educators in Massachusetts, does anyone want to participate in this? And I think originally they pitched 24 across the whole state. And as coming from Brockton, really what we wanted to know was, what is this next generation assessment? What does it look like, and what does that mean for our teachers and our students? So that's what sparked our interest in becoming part of this group. And there was an interview process, and you know, we had to be chosen to be part of that. But what it means is we attend state meetings, we attend national meetings. Both Eileen and I have had the privilege to present at state and national level based on the work that we've done here in Brockton. And we have been able to get the information first and firsthand right from the people who are making the decisions and bring it back to Brockton, as well as the obligation of spreading that word across the state. So we've presented all over.
So our motivation really was to help Brockton. We thought, get in front of this. It's a big change. We're a big district. We have a lot of teachers that we want to be able to provide professional development to. And so that was our number one motivation for doing this. And so another great piece about PARC is when we reach out to other districts, we share back and forth, and we're able to sort of, you know, bring back some things as well. So it's been a really wonderful opportunity for us, and it's been a great way to put Brockton on the map in a different way.
Mr. Gormley.
Have you heard in any real rationale as to why the state wants to move to an only online testing? It doesn't, as an educator, it doesn't make any sense to me, because we work all day on paper and pencil, and we're not a one-to-one district. And many districts in the state aren't.
Right.
And the infrastructure isn't there, certainly here, with the technology and where I work. I mean, we have to shut down our wireless network a couple times a year because our students get the password. So have they expressed, you know, the rationale and how bad of an idea it is yet?
I don't think it's come out quite that way. But,
well,
go ahead.
All right. So I think that... it's a challenge. And I think that having the test on the computer certainly creates challenges for people, especially if you don't have that one-to-one. Mm-hmm. But it also is a catalyst for making public education be able to provide their students with the technology that they need in order to be part of the 21st century and to be really successful. Mm-hmm. And so, I think it's pushing an agenda. It's pushing something across the country, really. Because if we're going to be able to compete with people in other countries who have maybe better technology, better broadband, those kinds of things, having this initiative where you have your assessment online is something that's helping to push to get us, move us into that, that arena. I also, if you want to, you can jump.
Well, I just think, and Brockton really has been very committed to making sure students have access to technology so that they can compete both locally and globally, which I think is so important. I mean, that is the world that they're going to be working in, and we want to make sure that from a very, very early age, students have that comfort and that access to the same resources that, you know, the W towns may have.
And our technology department is stellar. They really work so hard with the Office of Teaching and Learning. I just think that we can't say enough about how much that they've done, not only to be able to, you know, help us get devices in our hands, but they're really great about maintaining our network. And it's interesting because the schools that are online right now, we're getting there one step at a time, and you can see that it is possible. But for, you know, if you haven't been lucky enough to be picked as one of those schools, it seems like these are insurmountable hurdles that we have to overcome, but we're getting there, and we're getting there slowly. Unfortunately, we're facing many challenges budget-wise, but if we want our kids to be ready for the 21st century, this is something that we're really going to have to consider for the very near future.
And I just want to stress also that this is not just for testing. This is not the reason why we're really promoting technology. It really is about making sure that students have access to everyday curriculum. We have discovery education. They have a lot of science through the tech book, using the devices and using the technology. So the test is one way that they will be using it, but it is most certainly, that's not the be-all and end-all of why we have this technology and why we're using it in schools.
Right. I mean, I see the use every day in my school. And when I worked here, I worked with Dan Vigent real closely on a lot of things. And they do a great job of finding grants and finding money to buy devices. But you mentioned the W-Towns. They have one-to-one devices because they can afford it. Until the state decides that they're going to fund us for these things, I don't think that we should be forced to take
MCAS 2.0
online. And the data that we've got has showed us that the students didn't perform as well either. So it just seems like a really bad idea to push it so hard so quickly without having a real plan. Because it doesn't seem like there's a plan to make this effective.
I think that that timeline, did you want to say?
Well, yeah, I mean, the timeline is very ambitious. And I think this year was hard for us because we have never been a district that has sort of stalled. And the idea that we had a choice to add additional schools on the computer-based test, and we weren't able to do that this year, it was something that we all struggled with. But if we didn't have those devices in those schools to have the kids practice all year long, we didn't want to risk that. We didn't want to put the kids through that. So, you know, that is frustrating. I know the Superintendent Smith has actually talked about some struggles that we've been having with E-rate. I mean, if this is where the state is going, the availability of funding to support districts that are really going along and doing the right thing for kids, the funding needs to be there, and we're not necessarily seeing that either. But real concerns, real issues.
Mr. Gorman, I'm glad you brought that up because when we first got our results, we were clearly looking at our schools where we had spent a lot of time, technology, support, all those things were in place. And the state really wasn't talking about the difference between the paper test scores and the computer-based scores. And now finally, a directive's coming out from the commissioner is they are focusing on that too. And again, I think it is going to come down to making sure that when a child is in kindergarten, they have a one-to-one device, the teachers have opportunities. And I agree with you. We're using technology for so many areas. It's not just about testing. It is certainly to move them forward into what we keep saying, the 21st century. And I'm glad Deputy Superintendent Barry brought up the fact that, we keep having to take steps back when you talk about E-rate. And it isn't about sharing with the other suburbs who might not have had the bigger piece of the pie. We want them to have a piece, but we don't want our pie decreased. So they've got to really start to take a look at, how they can support our youngsters. And as I said, I know they're looking at the computer-based test versus the paper-based, and hopefully we'll start to get some information from the state on that. So thank you for bringing that up.
Mr. DeAgostino.
I've heard from constituent or two about opting their kid out of the testing, and talked a little bit about that with some folks. And if you were in my position and you were approached by somebody who was thinking of opting their child out of the testing, is there a downside to doing that, and what is it? What would you say to them to make them feel a little more comfortable and also then feel that they may want their child to participate in the testing?
So we started to experience some of that last year, and one of the distinctions that we have to make, because we're required to make it, is there really is no such thing as opt-out, unfortunately. If a family chooses to not have their child included, it's actually called a refusal. Mm-hmm. And the reason for that is because we are required to do an end-of-the-year state assessment in Massachusetts. So that's the one distinction. Every refusal went to the schools, and then they went to me, and I called every single parent last year, and it was really, really helpful for me to actually speak to parents and to really figure out where their concerns were supporting the kids through this new assessment. So we're going to follow the same process this year. And I can think of a number of reasons. Some have already come to light where kids are really anxious about this different type of test.
Right.
And parents feel that, well, if I have the choice, then I would rather opt out. But the reality is that it isn't exactly a choice because we have that state mandated test. I'm happy to follow up with you in any way, and we actually have some resources that were just made available to us because there are other districts that are dealing with this at a larger scale. We're a very, very big district, and I want to say last year we had about 15, and a lot of those refusals were siblings in the same families. So when you think about how big we are, that's not so bad. But it was nice to speak to every family individually and really talk to them about their concerns. One of the things that did come up was the idea that there are lots of formative assessment measures that we have in the district, but here's that summative assessment measure that you will actually get results on as a parent. If you don't have that year's results, you're not going to be able to see how your student is progressing on that state assessment if you choose to refuse the assessment. And so some parents are interested in that kind of longitudinal data and may feel a little bit different about the test. But I can actually, maybe we can put some resources in the Friday packet. I know we actually just got a number of them that I thought were really good. But the whole idea is really just reaching out and talking to parents about the reason why. A lot of kids are nervous. And what's funny is the idea about a test that's timed versus a test that's untimed, we were all in schools during MCAS when kids would just languish all day long and just, you know, kill themselves to perform on that test. Parents are nervous about the time test, but when you weigh the pros and cons around a time test versus a test that's untimed, they seem to understand that that might be more beneficial than they originally think.
So I would like to add also that I think very few students didn't finish in the time frame. And they gave students a survey on the computer based test, and we could get some data around that about how kids responded to it, and if they said that they enjoyed taking the test, and they responded really positively to taking the test. So sometimes it's fear of the unknown.
Yeah.
And if we can just sort of tell them as much as they need to know, tell them that so many kids have taken it and have been successful, then maybe we'll be able to quell their fears, and then they'll be able to get that nice data for their children that they might want to have.
Yes, and the teachers have been working really, really hard all year to prepare them for this, and we have an amazing, amazing city full of unbelievable teachers mm-hmm. that are getting their students ready for this assessment.
Right. We actually missed you up here. We were going to pull up a fourth chair.
I feel very strongly about this question, so I wanted to answer, because I'm pretty sure, Mr. D'Agostino, you asked, what should I do? Because constituents come to you. The thing that's important is you always want to do the best thing for the students. And the thing that I think that our presenters have made a pretty good case of, we're trying to prepare students for their future. Yes, it's a new test. You don't prepare for the future by ducking it. Brockton does well. It outperforms its demographic, not by ducking it. And so that's a big point. And if, you know, I talk to parents along, you know, send them to the deputy. I talked to them. Some of the concerns, honestly, are a little bit strange. What are they going to do with this information? I think the government's going to, you know, do crazy things in the future. Those, I don't know if you can rationally deal with, because they're irrational fears. Mm-hmm. But the other things, my student is stressed. Well, it's a very important skill to learn to deal with stress. I can't say that it's nice. I don't want to see a third grader stressed. I don't want to see a 10th grader stressed. You've got to deal with it, because life is about dealing with stress and overcoming challenges. So people come to you, what should you do? Definitely send them to their principal, send them to the deputy, and also just realize they're not helping their student, they're not helping the district. Our kids are prepared. It is a challenge, and you do well with challenges by facing them. Oh, and by the way, there's no stake. That's the interesting thing. There's no consequence. So I think that answers your question. I feel strongly about it, because they're outsiders, people outside education who are telling them this is a bad thing. People inside education aren't saying that. So is that helpful?
Yeah.
Great.
Thanks, Ethan.
So a person opts out in, let's say, middle school, but then goes on to Brockton High and allows their student in the 10th grade to take the tests and passes, they get their diploma, correct? Or do they not because they were, or how does it impact that they didn't take, they were a Brockton Public School student in 8th grade, but they opted out, but then in middle and in high school they opted in. How does that affect?
So the way that the refusal works is that it affects the school's participation rate, but there is no individual student penalty. And obviously the assessment that counts the most is that competency determination that, that the students actually participate in grade 10. So the one thing that I would say is you're not getting that, that data that shows you how a student is doing, but there's no penalty on that, that particular student. The school does have an impact on their participation rate. That would be one thing that I would say.
And you saw a school go from a level 2 to a level 1 based on participation rate.
Right.
So again, the children are prepared. You know, we need the parents.
Right.
When you talk about the stress factor, we need the parents to assure them that they've been taught well all year long, healthy eating the week before the test, always healthy eating. Make sure you get enough sleep. Make sure there's motivation in the family that the child can do it. Because truly, this is a part of competition they're going to face in college. It's all about a test. It's all about showing, you know, what you have learned. And again, I think I agree. You know, our teachers do an excellent job. There's supports for the families if they want to talk to their principals, talk to the Office of Teaching and Learning. There's honest conversation, and we're happy to answer any of those questions.
And it's just really good information for us to have, too, because knowing the reasons why families were, you know, what the concerns were, it really helped us to really talk to schools about, you know, ways in which they could address these things as they come up. So we'll continue to do that, and we actually do have some really good resources that I think would be helpful for you as well.
The other thing that I'll say to parents out there is when you talk about no consequences for the child, that while that might be true, when it comes to 10th grade and you've taken the test in 8th grade, you've taken the test in the lower grades, you have a sense of what that test is about. I wouldn't want to be a 10th grader taking it for the first time and not having, you know, it's all about practice tests and getting prepared. So I would really caution parents that this would be the opportunity for their students to see what the test is, whether it's online, whether it's paper and pencil, and to prepare for that 10th grade test, which is very meaningful.
I promise this will be my last question.
It's okay.
So, and I appreciate you, you know, giving me some time here on this. This is kind of an issue that's really been on my mind a lot. And taking myself out of being a school committee member for a minute and really thinking about it as a parent of a young child and very young. I mean, he's 13 months, so he's not facing any tests anytime soon.
Congratulations. The standards start in preschool.
So I look at that, and I think back to, and I think we're all probably somewhat close in age, the four of us, but I don't remember taking all these tests when we were in school. I mean, we had a placement test here and there to figure out what class we needed to be in, and I understand the need to assess where a student is so that the teacher knows, okay, what do I need to, you know, where is this student so that I can, you know, give them what they need. But at the same time, you know, are we, I'm trying to figure out how to word this, and we need to be able to take tests, obviously, professionally. I've had in my industry to take many tests over the years, and so certainly there is some value in learning to be able to do that, but do you feel that we're getting too close to excessive testing? Have we struck a balance?
We do worry about certain grade levels. One of the issues that we brought up before was particularly grade 3, when we were talking about students at that level who were English language learners, so they were taking the access test, they were taking, you know, shortly after that, they were taking the Iowa Test of Basic Skills before. One of the things that we were talking about was thinking about our online assessment system, which is a lot faster, trying to utilize some of the other existing things that we have so that those kids in grade 3 aren't walking through months and months of tests. We are always looking at the number of tests that we give as a district. We obviously have state mandated assessments that we have to give, and then we have formative assessments that really drive our curriculum instruction and inform any kind of remediation that teachers need to actually do. What we do, however, is when we're thinking about district assessments, and we do have district assessments at all levels, we want to make sure that we have a balanced number and that those assessments inform what the teacher is doing with students. If they're not, then we don't necessarily see that point. So really finding that balance, particularly with the assessments that we control as a district, is something that we're always doing. So we can't do anything about the state assessments except prepare our kids as best we can, but we do have control over the ones that we actually utilize as a district. And I would say that the assessments that we use in the district really inform, the type of instruction that teachers are providing, the types of safety nets that they actually need to provide for kids. And in that way, we want to make sure that we continue to offer them.
The assessments we administer in district as well mirror the state assessments in smaller doses.
Right.
So it definitely is there for teachers to be able to see the types of questions and the rigor of the state assessments, so that they're modeled after that in smaller doses, so that it can really inform teachers and inform their instruction. So it's important.
And just for one answer to your question, I'm a lot older than you, by the way, and I didn't have as many assessments.
That was sweet of him.
Thank you. I didn't have as many assessments in school as kids do today. And it's interesting. You have to ask yourself, what's the reason why, right? And so it really goes back to, 1993, 91, 92, the nation at risk, that as a nation, we have a responsibility to educate our children so that they're successful in life. And we have different measures that we use to do that. And we found that against other countries that we were losing, we found that even within the United States, that some states scored higher on national states than other states did. So it turns into kind of like a student's right to get that public education, and it's about equity. And so what these tests are doing for us are to help us, do a summative quick assessment as quick as possible, because it's a very comprehensive test, right? And to be able to say, where is your child? Are they falling through the cracks? And if they are, we have the responsibility to get them to where they need to go. So honestly, as tests very often have a very negative, pejorative sort of meaning to them these days. And what we want to think about is that, like any other institution or organization, it's a way that we sort of dipstick to try to find out how are we doing. Are we doing the best for our students that we can possibly do? And for students to be able to perform independently should be a good thing. If I were a baseball coach, I would get in a lot of trouble if I just had my kids sit on the bench all the time and not get up and independently play. And so what we're asking kids to do a little bit more than maybe you and I had to do when we were in school is to show us what you can do independently so that we can really help you to get better and to be where you need to be. So that's what I think about that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so let me finish up here. Items to refer to subcommittee. So, Mr. Minicello, at some point we need to do again the superintendent. I want to go over the goals. And I know that you have a charting the course, I believe, coming up on, is it Saturday, April 2nd in West Bridgewater? I know a number of you are... taking that. And there will be a presentation, if it's as in the past, on evaluating the superintendent, developing goals. So I would hope to follow up very soon after that. I know the Easter holiday is March, so I'm hoping that we could take a Saturday morning for a couple of hours, provide support for you as to the measures that we've employed in the past, but I want to be able to present the strategic plan tied into the superintendent's goals.
Okay, we'll circulate some dates.
Okay.
Saturdays?
I was hoping we could do a couple of hours in the early morning on a Saturday so as not to take away your day.
As you're looking at which Saturdays, maybe two are doing April 2nd, and two of us are doing May 7th. May 7th?
Okay, good.
Okay, great.
We were thinking as soon as April 9th. And again, we could do it early, 8 to 10, 8:30 to 10:30. You know, just I think we just need a couple of hours.
Great. Okay.
Okay. And I want to finish up just with two things. One is we do have at West Middle School, I believe we were informed just today that we have a special guest possibly coming from the Patriots. I'm not allowed to tell you who it is. Tomorrow morning at 9 a.m. Am I allowed to, Mr. Deputy Superintendent Thomas told me it was embargoed.
Well, I mean, you just announced
it on page. I didn't say who.
You can say.
So our children took part in a special program. I believe the teacher had an outreach to the Patriots to talk about some of the good natures of what children were doing in the class. So tomorrow at 9 a.m. we have Patriot player Malcolm Butler joining us here in Brockton. So we're all excited, and we're all invited, Dr. Murray?
Oh, sure.
So I just don't want you to be surprised, because we were just surprised. And I do want to finish up with a comment. We started out with a prayer for Jim Daly, and I do want to say that I worked with Mr. Daly actually as the Director of Community Schools when I came on in 2001. He was on the Community School Advisory Board. He was on a number of things in the district, PAC, task forces, and I want to say the one thing about Mr. Daly was he always was a voice for our students, for their parents, for the community, making sure that they all had access to programs. Certainly this was untimely, his death. I'm sorry, certainly to his family, to his lovely daughter, who he was totally devoted to, and again, our sincere condolences from the Brockton Public Schools.
Did you want to say something, Mrs. Sullivan?
That's exactly what I was going to say, how, you know, he really cared about the schools and about the students and parents, and that he served on many boards, for the schools and in Brockton, in the community. He served on Brockton Interfaith and also in his church on the board for Prince of Peace Church, the Lutheran Church on North Main Street, where his service will be on Saturday.
Do they have a time on that?
11 a.m. on Saturday. Yeah. And as Superintendent Smith said, it was, you know, a tragedy, his death. He was going to have some spinal surgery that was needed to fuse some of the vertebrae in his neck, because if he didn't have the surgery done, he could become a quad. So it was really, you know, afterward he developed some blood clots that one of them went to his lung and it killed him. He was only 60 years old, and he served for 8 years on the school committee. He was a very dedicated servant to the schools, to the students, to the parents, and he was a really good friend of mine. He was a great guy to talk to. You could call him up and you could go over, you know, all the problems of the city and solve them within a matter of minutes. he was a very kind and caring man, and if you knew him, then you knew somebody that was really good.
Very nice. Thank you, Mrs. Sullivan.
And that's it.
Okay. Any unfinished business?
New business? So new business, in front of you, you have our calendar for next year. So we'd like you to take a look at it so we can possibly vote on it at our next school committee meeting. One of the things we'd like to bring to your attention, something a little bit different, according to the contract with the Brockton Education Association, we can't start school any earlier than September 1st. September 1st this year actually falls on a Thursday. Labor Day is not until September 5th. So we are recommending having the teachers come back on Thursday, September 1st. Friday would be a day off, and certainly the Labor Day Monday would, so it would be a long weekend, and the students would be able to report on Tuesday. So that is a little bit different than something we've done in the past. As you can see, the other thing, we do have the election day in there. So during that week with the election day, it is a presidential election on November 8th, the Tuesday. We also have the Friday, that's where Veterans Day falls, so you end up with 2 days off in that week. Our Christmas recess is interesting because Christmas is on a Sunday. And when you have a legal holiday on the Sunday, it's celebrated on the Monday. It doesn't affect us during the Christmas recess break, but it does affect us in coming back. So even though the 1st of January is on a Sunday, we would observe the holiday on the 2nd of January. So that's why you'll see the 2nd Monday being a day off. We're very fortunate this year, and do I dare say this, I don't know where this would, but as far as the winter that we have been through, if we are finished with it, our teachers and students are set to be finished their 180 days on June 17th. I can only remember one other time with an earlier end date. Nick, honest to goodness.
Thank you, Madam Superintendent, changing the course of
absolutely
history.
The weather. I can do the weather too. Interesting. I get blamed for that also. So again, we have the last day of school slated as June 23rd. That doesn't include the 5 snow days that we always build into the calendar if we weren't to use those snow days. It does include it the 23rd. If we did not use them, it would revert back to June 16th. So you take each day off for days we do not use, such as this year, we had it built in, and as I said, we're at the 17th right now. So we'd like you to take a first look.
Great.
Any questions?
Ms. Plant.
For several years, we used to go back on the Wednesday after Labor Day. And as a parent, I have to say, I loved that, because you'd have the Monday holiday, you didn't have to worry about getting home too early, the kids didn't have school on Tuesday. Has that been an issue that anybody other than me has brought up?
I'm sure people will. As I said, we took a look at this calendar, and I think, again, when we look back at last year, I'm not sure how we got through that. We've been very careful. We've worked with our teachers union to, you know, make sure we don't have too many interruptions, you know, during the calendar months. And one of the things, even when you look at that Tuesday, we want to be able to start with a 4-day week. I have parents that say to me, you know, we're starting on Wednesday, you know, that's just 3 days that week, so there is some talk. We could certainly go back and forth, but that is going to be our recommendation. According to the contract, we can start with the teachers, you know, anytime after, you know, September 1st and on. So it does happen to fall on the Thursday, and we were looking again. I think when you look at this year, you're going to have parents and teachers who are going to be very, very pleased to get out on June 17th to start their summer vacations. Some students are working, you know, looking to pay for college, so our kids will be out in a timely manner, which hasn't happened in the past. And when I talk about last year, somehow we got through with, did we have 5 snow days last year, which were built in? And there were many communities taking away April vacation, taking extra days here and there. So again, because of those changes, I want to make sure we have things built in that we're not going into June, you know, 29th, 30th, et cetera. So that was one of our thinking is, you know, September 1st is the Thursday, get the teachers back, they set up their classrooms, they spend time doing that. The Friday and the Monday, everybody could have a long weekend. Certainly the families wouldn't be disrupted. And we were hoping the students starting on Tuesday, teachers would be ready to come back. You would have a 4-day work week and a 4-day school week. So that was the thinking. Thank you.
I also hear some parents complaining that other districts start at the end of August, and that we're always one of the late districts. We're always after Labor Day, where some districts start the week before Labor Day. So it's like there's always going to be some that like it, some that don't. And then what was it? Was it last year? We only had 3 days in the first week? Or the way it was broken up, there was was it last year that was broken up very odd, the way the school started?
I have the calendar. I'll have to take a look.
Well, one year it was very odd, and parents were like, why are we coming back a day and then leave?
Last year, teachers did report on Tuesday the 1st, and we did start school on the 2nd. But the way Labor Day would fall this year, as I said, Labor Day would be the 5th. We wouldn't be starting teachers until the 6th, students until the 7th, and we just felt we were losing traction with getting the kids back in school.
And this way we're out in a reasonable time at the end of the summer, so that's good. So, in light of some of our schools not having air conditioning, I think they, you know, who wants to be in school June 23rd, you know, when the heat's beating down on the kids, you know. Mr. DeAgostino.
Just a silly thing I noticed. Maybe what I'm looking at is wrong, but June 23rd on here shows a Monday. I think it's a Friday.
We could very well have made a mistake. We went back and forth on this, thank you.
Okay.
Yeah, as is June 16th, they're both Fridays. The date you see down below,
calendar.
June 16th is a Friday also. That's pretty amazing.
Yeah, Mark, go through this and make sure all those days correspond, please. Thank you.
You're
thank you. What a guy. Okay.
That has happened.
Okay. Anything else, Mr. DeAgostino?
No.
Nothing?
I actually have a question.
Ms. Azak.
So why is it that in November they don't have school on Election Day, but September they...
You're talking about the primaries?
They've always had school? Oh, okay.
We've looked at, and of course we use the schools. We have certainly looked at the volume of people coming through, and I know in the last presidential election, you know, the numbers were huge, and we don't want to put the safety of our students, our teachers, so we have closed down for gubernatorial elections. This past year we also did with a mayoral election.
Okay.
Yeah, if on an election day, if you just hang out in one of the parking lots of a school, I mean, you have people that shouldn't be driving that show up to vote. And, you know, at the Hancock, I can tell you, some people are coming in the wrong, you know, the exit.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, so it's just, it's chaos. It really is. So it's much safer
Have
the students,
I agree.
You know, on site, so to speak, you know.
No, definitely. It's all about safety.
Yeah.
Anyone else? Okay. Nothing for executive session. Okay, if nothing else, can we have a motion to adjourn?
Wow.
Second? All in favor? Thank you for attending.